Assalamu alaikum and hello to everyone. In this lecture video, we are going to explore the transition from pneumatics to electro-pneumatics. So, why do we use electro-pneumatics in the first place? Well, there are plenty of reasons, among which we are going to highlight a number of them. First of all, the switching time of our valve in electro-pneumatics is quite faster. And secondly, the signal speed. Since we are using electric current, so the speed of the signal is the speed of light. And thirdly, and this one is going to be highlighted more specifically, the distance from the signal input. So let us look at the pneumatic circuit where we have signal input and also our final control element. So the signal has to travel all the way from the signal input through the pipes and tubes all the way to our final control element, and this distance, as the input button gets farther and farther, the distance becomes longer and longer, and this will incur a lot of losses in terms of pressure drop. Whereas in an electro-pneumatic system, we don't have pressure flowing through pipes. However, we only have electric current flowing through wires. So we have overcome this shortcoming, and this is an advantage. What are the components that could appear in an electro-pneumatic system? Well, there are plenty of them, and I leave it to the viewer to go through these components. However, I just want to highlight that the ones in green are the pneumatic components, which we are still using. Although we are in electro-pneumatic system, we still have pneumatic components. And on the right side in blue color is the electric or electric components. However, there are components that must not appear in our electro-pneumatic circuit, and they are in red color, such as the shuttle valve, which is the OR gate, and also the dual pressure valve. Why do we still use pneumatic actuation? This is a question which is always posed by our viewers. Why do we still use pneumatic actuators? Why not replace them by electric motors? Well, the reason is pneumatic actuation costs less and also brings higher force, higher speed, and it is overload proof. And what is overload proof? Overload proof simply means when you overload the motor, pneumatic motor, it will not spoil it. Pneumatic versus electro-pneumatic. In terms of components, we have here our pneumatic power section, as well as in the electro-pneumatics, we have our pneumatic power section. So we are not replacing our power section. We are only going to replace the part which lies in the signal control section, which is basically these components are going to be replaced. Yeah, so we are going to replace the pilot by a solenoid, and we are going to retain our power section. The difference in signal medium: in pneumatics we have compressors which provides signal to both power section and also signal control section, whereas in electro-pneumatics we have compressors plus the DC power supply. Electro-pneumatics face two risk factors with regard to power supply failure. Why? Just now we have presented that we have two power supplies in the case of electro-pneumatics, that is pneumatic pressure represented by the compressor and also the electric DC supply. So we have one risk factor, and the second risk factor is in the case of failure of the DC power supply. So what is the new signal medium in electro-pneumatics? That is the electric current. And what component provides that signal? It is the DC power supply. In electro-pneumatics, where does the pneumatic circuit receive signal from? So in an electro-pneumatic circuit, we have our pneumatic part. And where does that part receive signal from? It receives signal from the electric circuit. But which part of it? It comes from the solenoid. From the solenoid, a signal will be sent to our final control element to be switched on and off. This is a review of the concept, the difference in concept. In pneumatic, we are looking at transfer of energy, whereas in electro-pneumatics, we are looking at the position of component with regard to normally open and normally closed contact. What does that mean? In pneumatics, we are looking at the transfer of energy. So when we say it is normally open valve, so open here refers to the energy. Open refers to energy. So the energy is open means energy is flowing. Whereas in the electric case, when we say we have a normally open switch, open here refers to the position of the component. Position of the component. So the position of the component is it is an open component. So when the component is in open position, energy is not flowing. So this is basically from the perspective of the concept behind pneumatics and electro-pneumatics. So you need to bear in mind that normally open here in pneumatics doesn't mean normally open in electrical circuit. What are the benefits of manual override? When we talk about DCV in electro-pneumatics, they are solenoid driven, and most of the designs come with a manual override. So what is a manual override? It is a safety feature that allows actuation of the DCV even during failure. Failure of what? Of either power supply, meaning there is no power supply, or as the solenoid itself fails. When the solenoid fails, we still can actuate manually using this manual override. What are the benefits of a pilot solenoid DCV? So what is a pilot? A pilot is an assistance. This is an assistance accessory which uses pneumatic pressure, as shown by this triangular shape, pneumatic pressure. It assists what? It assists our solenoid. And what is the benefit? By the aid of this pilot, we can reduce the size of our solenoid. Secondly, we can have a less power consumption. Since our solenoid is small, so the power consumption becomes lesser. And it can increase the force actuation. So by having this assistance, we can increase the actuation force. And lastly, when we have higher actuation forces, we can have bigger valves that allow for larger or bigger flow capacity. So we can have bigger valves that allow more pressure to flow at the same time. And this pilot could also be called pilot operated, piloted, or other names such as servo, servo assisted. And they could be either internal or external. Internal refers to the fact that the pressure here is taken from the inside of the valve, whereas external means the pressure here, it is taken from an external circuit. How to implement AND or NOT logics? In electromagnetics, we are still using these logics. However, the way to implement it is different. So for AND, we need to combine two switches in series. For OR, two switches in parallel, and also a NOT logic, which is represented by a normally closed switch. What are the types of contacts? We have three types of contacts: normally closed, normally open, and a changeover, which combines both of the previous ones. So we have two in one: normally closed plus normally open. And these contacts must have numbers, and these numbers are fixed, so they always come in this configuration: 1, 2 for normally closed, 3, 4 for normally open, and 1, 2, 4 for the changeover contact. This is an example of a couple of input switches, such as push button shown in normally open, normally closed, and changeover configuration. So a push button has a dashed line, which refers to what? A mechanical link between the push button and the contact. So this dashed line actually shows a mechanical link. And then a set button, and the difference between set and push button is push button does not retain the position. So once you push it, it will return after release. However, set button, it maintains the position. Once you push the button, it maintains that position until the second time the button is pushed. And lastly, we have a relay contact. A relay contact is not manually actuated, whereas set button, push button are manually operated. So relay contact is operated by the relay coil. Again, we have the same three types: normally open, normally closed, changeover, and these are the outputs: solenoid, buzzer, and lamp. We often see poles. With regard to contacts, a pole refers to the first figure in the numbering system. So here it is 1, which refers to pole 1, 2 refers to pole 2, and 3 refers to pole 3. And what is the second number? That is the contact number. So 3, 4 means normally open, 3, 4 again means normally open, and again 3, 4 means normally open. So what is the benefit of a multi-pole contact? So once this push button is pressed, 3 of the poles simultaneously will be pressed as well. We have to be familiarized with the new symbols in electronumatics. So S refers to any manual or mechanical switch, whether it is normally open or normally closed, set button or roller lever valve, all of them are referred to S. And B refers to any proximity switch, such as optical switch, inductive switch, capacitive switch, reed switch, and pressure switch. All of them are referred to B. And K refers to relay coil and also the relay contact. And Y refers to the solenoid, whereas H refers to a buzzer or a lamp. We often see initially activated contact. So what is initially activated contact? A contact that comes initially in activated configuration. This is a symbol of it. So you need to place the symbol next to the contact when it is initially activated. Okay, there is some important note. Since we see the number next to the contact to be 1, 2, and 1, 2, we know that 1, 2 refers to a normally closed contact, but why do we see it as an open contact? Okay, I repeat, 1, 2, these two numbers refer to a normally closed, which means something like this. However, the number refers to normally closed, but the contact shows normally open. So this is because it is initially activated, which means somebody has modified the contact and opened it up. That's why we see it open. So likewise, you can apply this similar concept here. 3, 4 refers to normally open. However, here it is shown as normally closed. Why? Because it is initially actuated. Okay. There are a couple of questions. Can we have initially actuated push button? No. The answer is no. Push buttons are manually operated and they don't come as initially actuated contact. How do we know read switch is normally open? So this is a read switch. How do we know that this is a normally open? Because it is drawn at the symbol here. Normally open read switch. How do we decide a contact should be initially actuated? So this refers to the fact that when we design a circuit, how do we know that we should place this symbol or not? So the one who is eligible to answer this question is the one who knows how is the system operated in the beginning. If the system operates and the contact is already pressed, so you should add that symbol in the drawing. However, if the system is operated and the contact is not on, so you should not add this symbol. How does relay contact become initially actuated? Okay, so this is a relay contact. How does it become initially actuated? When the relay coil is on initially. So if this relay coil is on initially, so the contact will be initially actuated. And this is the end of the lecture. I hope that you had benefited from it, and hope to see you again in the next lesson. Thank you for watching, and see you next time.